What is the most expensive book ever advertised? I'm not talking about one-off handwritten books like Bill Gates paid $30.8 million for Leonardo da Vinci's original handwritten notes, and someone paid a similar amount of money for the handwritten draft of the Book of Mormon, the book, not the stage production. I'm talking about run-of-the-mill, standard production-printed books. Something, dare I say, fungible. And the record at just over $23 million is held by a 1992 book about fruit fly genetics.
Hey, look, it's Buzzy the fruit fly, but they look sad. What's up, Buzzy?
No one ever remembers what genes I have.
Well, Buzzy, have you tried The Making of a Fly by Peter Lawrence? It's a book jam full of details about your genetics, covering everything from your dorsoventral system to your segment polarity genes.
Well, and anything else?
Yes. It covers your anteroposterior gradient, intragenic recombination, and urogenesis and spacing pattern.
I don't know. It sounds a lot like you're just reading the index.
Look, this script was written by a mathematician. The point is, this is the go-to reference text for biology people who work with fruit flies. It's got all the developmental biology and molecular genetics you could ever ask for.
I'll take it.
Excellent. And this book can be yours for only $23,698,653.93, plus $3.99 shipping and handling.
I actually bought a copy of the book, but I got it at a pretty serious discount of 99.9999423% off. I paid about $13.68, plus I got free shipping, which is pretty good. I bought this when I was writing my book, Humble Pie, all about math mistakes, of which this is a great example. It also appears briefly in the stage show of the same name. And because it's kind of a blink and you'll miss it part of my show, which I'm about to film, I thought it'd be good to do a whole video about what went wrong with this book so I can look at it in detail. By the way, if you want to help Kickstarter that filming, you absolutely can, because the more support I get, the more and better cameras plus camera crew I'm able to afford. There'll be details about that at the end of the video and in the description below. But for now, let's have a look at how the pricing of this book went so horribly wrong.
To clarify, of course, anyone can charge whatever they want for any book. I could say all copies of Humble Pie now cost $1 billion, although I can't, because you can buy it for a perfectly normal price. And in this case, the book was genuinely and earnestly listed for $23 and a bit million, plus $3.99 postage and shipping. And it's not like there were other cheaper copies of the book. All the copies of the book were tens of millions of dollars. And hypothetically, if someone bought one of them, barring any bank limits or transfer issues, $23 million would disappear from their account and a copy of this book would be sent to them. The book was honestly been sold for this amount of money, and it wasn't a joke, it wasn't a prank, it was a horrible misfiring of automatic pricing systems. The Making of a Fly is an important reference book for people who do fruit fly genetics research. However, it is now out of print, which makes getting a new copy a bit difficult. And one day, when someone at the University of California, Berkeley Fruit Fly Research Lab needed another copy of The Making of a Fly, they went onto Amazon and there were 17 copies available. 15 of those were used, and to be honest, they did start from around $35.54. However, there were two new copies, and those started at $1,730,045.91. Something was clearly up. Initially, the people at the lab contacted the author of the book, Peter Lawrence, and said, "Hey, have you seen how much your book is selling for? There are two new copies on Amazon for more than $1 million. And everyone had a good laugh and figured the price would return to normal soon enough. But it didn't. By the end of the next day, one of the books was now listed for over $3.5 million, and the other one was rapidly catching up as well. All fruit fly research was put aside in the lab and a spreadsheet was started to track the price of this book. There were two sellers, one named Prof Naff and one named Bawdy Book, and every day they would both increase their price but in a very specific ratio compared to what the other person had it listed at. It seems Bawdy Book wanted their copy to cost just over 27% more than Prof Nath's copy, and Prof Nath wanted their copy to cost about 0.17% less than Bawdy Book's. And the fact that there was this constant ratio being applied every single day systematically, as well as the overly specific prices and their ridiculous magnitude, these users were obviously not setting the prices themselves. They had both employed bots, automatic systems to set the prices for them, and they were employing very different strategies.
Hey there, Buzzy. Looks like you've got yourself plenty of copies of The Making of a Fly.
I sure do, mysterious disembodied voice.
And I hear you've been selling them online so everyone can learn about fruit fly genetics.
Yeah, but I'm getting real sick of constantly having to update the listings whenever I need to change the price.
Well, have I got some more shilling for you. Introducing the latest in automatic pricing robot technology, Bawdy Book and ProfNap. They can adjust your prices according to simple but strategic rules. Bawdy Book, this robot lies for you. Let's say you don't actually have the book yourself, but your seller reviews are so good, people will ironically pay a premium to use your service. As long as you charge more than the book actually costs, if anyone orders it, you can then buy a copy to pass on to them. This robot makes it all possible by setting your prices to be 1.270589 times the second most expensive. And that extra 27% premium is enough to actually purchase a copy and have some profit left over. ProfNath, let's say you actually own the book you claim to, but want to charge as much as you can while still being the cheapest by mere pennies, you sly seller, you. This robot will set your price to be 0.9983 times the second cheapest. So if someone else had a copy for $20, yours would be $19.97, and that sale is yours.
That's it?
That's it.
No other rules or if-then statements? They both just blindly multiply the other price by a fixed ratio?
You got it! It's so simple, it can't go wrong! If there's a book for sale at $20, then Bawdy Book sets their price to $25.41. ProfNath charges $19.97, and everyone is happy.
But what if these robots are the only two sellers? If you multiply their ratios, 1.270589 times 0.9983 is 1.26843, and that's bigger than one. The price would increase by 26.84% per day, every day, forever, spiraling out of control.
Technically, yes, but that's never gonna happen.
But exactly that did happen. There were only two copies, and the prices went up day after day after day after day until they were in the tens of millions. And then one day, ProfNath broke rank. There's a tiny possibility the ProfNath bot had a built-in limit of like $20 million, but that feels unlikely. More likely, a human saw what the bots were doing, stepped in, and put the price back down to a much more reasonable $106.23. For some definition of reasonable, and then Bawdy Book fell into line, and all was well with the world. That said, we don't know how often this happens. If pricing bots were to spiral out of control going down, someone would just buy the book and it would stop. And if they spiral up, normally a human would see it or someone would happen to buy it and it would stop. But there could be complex webs of pricing bots all interacting and strange things happening. And only occasionally, like this, do we see the result manifest itself in a ridiculous price. But surely, surely something like this wouldn't happen in an important financial market. On the 6th of May 2010 at 2:40 p.m., the US stock market crashed. The Dow Jones dropped by 9%, the biggest one-day decrease since the crashes of 1929 and 1987. But in this case, 20 minutes later, it uncrashed. The stock market jumped back up pretty much to where it was before it all began. A crash followed by an anti-crash. I have no idea what stock traders do during an anti-crash. I assume jump back in through windows and blow cocaine out of their noses. Even though it was over as fast as it started, what a 20 minutes it was. 2 billion shares were traded with a total volume of over 56 billion US dollars. And over 20,000 of those trades were at prices more than 60% away from what the stock was worth at 2:40 p.m. when it all started. And many of these trades were at irrational prices. Those are prices as low as 1 cent per stock, or as high as $100,000 per share. It was absolute temporary chaos. There is still not a complete consensus about what caused this, but it seems the inciting incident was a trader dumping 75,000 future contracts called E-minis all at once on a Chicago financial exchange. They were worth, combined, about 4.1 billion US dollars, the third biggest comparable sale within the previous 12 months. But while the two previous sales have been done gradually over the course of a day, this sale was completed in 20 minutes. When a sale like this is done gradually by a human trader or a nuanced financial bot, it is absolutely fine. But this sale used a bot completely blind to what the market was doing, and it just continued to make it rain E-minis with no regard for what the price may be or how fast the sales were being made. And this sudden, blunt release of E-minis slammed into the market and sent other high-frequency trading bots absolutely haywire. The futures contracts being sold soon swamped any natural demand, and the high-frequency trading bots just began to swap them between themselves. In the 14 seconds between 2:45 and 13 seconds p.m. and 2:45 and 27 seconds, over 27,000 contracts were passed between these automatic trading bots. That alone equaled the volume of all other trading. This was the big short circuit. Thankfully, the markets did bounce back to normal as all the high-frequency trading algorithms sorted themselves out. Some of them had things like safety switches, like cutoffs built in, which suspended their trading when prices moved around too much, and they would only restart after a human had manually checked what was going on. And therein lies the moral to the story. As well as not having ridiculously blunt E-mini sales bots, when you do program any kind of automatic trading or pricing bot, you need to have sensible limits around what it's allowed to do and try to keep a human in the loop. Because there's nothing wrong with automatic bots, but their algorithms need to have sensible limits built in to keep them from going haywire. And when you have a complex web of bots all interacting, there are always going to be extreme edge cases that no programmer will ever be able to think of. So it's always best to keep a human as near to in the loop as possible.
Hey, Buzzy, it looks like you've made quite the profit selling those books.
I sure did. Thanks for your help.
No problem. But how about now you pay some of that cash forward and help kickstart Matt Parker's new stand-up show filming?
Nah, I'm good.
Oh, come on! The show was a sellout sensation at the Edinburgh Festival Fringe and contains hilarious stories of maths going wrong.
I'm quite happy just accounting my money. And besides, the book and the robots made sense in the context of this video, but
this feels like shameless unrelated promotion.
Buzzy, we've been through this. It is relevant because the story of, you know, you in the book is in my book and it's in the show I'm trying to film, and not only is it relevant and valid to bring up at the end of this video, but I do need to promote the Kickstarter because without that, I can't do the filming. Traditionally, I would have had a big tour, sold loads of tickets, had several nights in the filming venue at the end, and all those ticket sales fund the filming of the DVD release. However, the pandemic meant I had to cancel the second half of the tour. And now I'm doing the minimum number of dates to remember the show, and then a reduced capacity filming at the end. So I need the Kickstarter support to be able to film it. I've penciled in the minimum crew required and a few cameras, so if we hit the target, the filming will definitely happen. But the more support I get, the better the filming gets. I've got more people who are prepared to come and help out. They can hire better and more expensive cameras. Always more expensive. They can, like, even the lenses. You pay for the lenses separate. It's ridiculous. But there is no upper bound to how good this can be. I have lightly penciled in the hiring of a jib. That's like one of those, like, mini cranes you put a camera on. You know what? Enough support. I'll get a crane and a crane-op. Let's go wild. Also, might get a second laser. At the moment, it's a one laser show, which, that's a bit embarrassing. How 2019 of me? Enough support? More lasers, more watts. Ah, it's gonna be so good. So I really want this show to exist in a form that it can live on. And the more support we get, the better the manifestation of that final form. So please do check out the Kickstarter. And that, Buzzy, is why you should use your mediumly hard-earned money to help support my filming.
Look, my life expectancy is like 2 weeks, so you're going to have to hurry up and explain what I get out of this deal.
No, that's
maybe I can.
Sorry, disembodied voice. I forget you exist.
Well, I do exist, and thought maybe I can help explain the many perks on offer.
Okay. Yes, please do.
Hey, everyone. Check out these perks. For a small amount of money, you'll get a digital download of the show and a thank you photo from set. Yes, Matt is going to individually display every supporter's name on the show's arcade machine and take a photo of him giving a thumbs up. For a medium amount of money, you get all that, your name in the credits, and a limited edition USB stick of the show, signed by Matt and hand-numbered from 0 to 1023. And for a big ol' pile of money, you can be an executive producer. You can give notes on early edits of the show, have your name in the onstage laser credits, and plus all those other things I just said.
I think I'll just wait for the official release and get it a bit cheaper.
Yes, but people get their name in the credits. And they get a USB stick.
I don't know. This whole thing just sounds like pre-orders with an extra step.
If you can, please do support the Kickstarter. I'll link to it below. You can get all the details and maybe get your name displayed on the Pac-Man arcade on the set and possibly up in laser light. Eh? Totally worth it. We're also filming it on the 21st of April in London at the Bloomsbury Theatre. If you want to come along, details below. And if you can't afford to Kickstarter it, that's absolutely fine. Wait until it comes out as a standard digital release. It's a bit cheaper that way as well. Although, you won't get immortality via the medium of laser credits. Come on, laser credits.